Thank you for joining us this evening. We're playing opening slides. Live from NYPL and the Thomas Yoseloff Business Center present The Heart of Business, Hubert Joly with Arianna Huffington, June 28, 2021, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. This slide contains an image of the featured book. The cover illustration is formed in the shape of a heart and shows a diverse crowd of people walking about in work attire. The text reads, Hubert Joly, The Heart of Business, Leadership Principles for the Next Era of Capitalism. The Heart of Business is available for purchase from the library shop, on.nypl.org/shoplive. Proceeds benefit the New York Public Library. Reserve a copy for free with a New York Public Library card. Visit tonight's event page to find this title in a variety of formats, nypl.org/live. The next slide shows reading recommendations from Hubert Joly, Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl, What Got You Here Won't Get You There by Marshall Goldsmith, Thrive by Arianna Huffington, In Search of Lost Time by Marcel Proust, Just Mercy by Brian Stevenson. The last slide shows recommended reading from Arianna Huffington, Meditations by Marcus Aurelius, Think Again by Adam Grant, Memories, Dreams, Reflections by Carl Jung, Your Time to Thrive by Marina Kadekel, Alone Together by Sherry Turkle. Check out the full list by visiting tonight's event page, nypl.org/live.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Tony Marks. I'm the president of the New York Public Library, and it's my absolute pleasure to welcome you to this great live event. We are so pleased to be joined tonight by Hubert Joly, the author of the new important book, The Heart of Business. Hubert is the former CEO, transformative CEO of Best Buy. He's currently teaching at the Harvard Business School, where he's been recognized as one of the great business leaders of his generation. He's also on the board of Johnson & Johnson and Ralph Lauren, amongst other important endeavors. He'll be joined tonight by Arianna Huffington, of course, the CEO of Thrive Global, as well as the founder of Huffington Post. Tonight's conversation seems so appropriately timed. We are at a moment when all of us are trying to rethink after the most traumatic and challenging 15 months I think any of us have lived through, certainly collectively. Rethink what our values are, rethink how we can ensure people's livelihoods and security in every aspect. How do we rethink how capitalism works? How that we can ensure the productivity that we need and ensure that people are getting what they need along the way. Hubert has broken through on these topics. His understanding of the centrality of people and purpose is what not only saved Best Buy, but made it the dominant force in its industry. And in doing so, he has demonstrated for all of us, as we'll discuss tonight, what it takes to give people that sense of purpose, to give organizations that sense of purpose, and to propel them into a future that isn't just about profits, but is about making sure the world works for all of us. I can't think of two people who I'm more looking forward to hearing in conversation. Both visionaries, both supporters of the library and friends, both folks who have and are rethinking and demonstrating for us what it looks like to reconsider how we're going to go forward together. For business purposes, Hubert's book is available for purchase through the library shop if you wish, though of course you're most welcome to come and borrow it from the library. We're also partnering this evening's event with the Thomas Yoseloff Business Center, a brand new entire floor facility at our brand new Stavros Niarchos Foundation Library on 40th and 5th. The Business Center is really unmatched in the city, is providing free access to unmatched resources, data, Bloomberg terminals, amazing staff offering free one-on-one advice on a range of business topics to help people find jobs, create jobs, build their businesses. We know those folks are going to be so eager to hear tonight's conversation as well. There will be questions afterwards, with thanks to Hubert and Arianna to agree to that. You can raise your questions on chat here on the Zoom through Google form or by emailing publicprograms@nypl.org. I should also say that because tonight's event's platform is hosted, it's hosted on YouTube, which does share data. So because the library takes your privacy, everyone's privacy, so seriously, we wanted you to be aware of that and act accordingly. And now, without further ado, my dear friends and great collaborators, please join me in welcoming Hubert Joly and Arianna Huffington.
Thank you so much, Tony, for this beautiful introduction. And I love your background. I think it's really spectacular how it evokes the grandeur and the beauty of the public library. Hubert, I'm so happy and excited to be here with you. And as the author of 15 books, I want to congratulate you on your impeccable timing. When you start on a book, you never know where the world is going to be when your book is published. And somehow, the themes of your book are so resonant and so perfect for the times we're living through. And one of my questions is, were you prophetic? How did that happen? How is it that I'm reading the book and it feels as though I'm reading today's newspaper in terms of the problems we're addressing, except with incredible depth, ancient wisdom, great metaphors, and an enormous amount of tools and techniques to respond to the current moment? So how did it happen?
You're so kind, Arianna, and I so look forward to our conversation. So I did not forecast anything that happened last year, believe me. The themes, I think what happens, the themes that are in the book about the importance of leading with purpose and humanity were very relevant before last year. They became even more relevant. And there was a moment, Arianna, last year, maybe all of us probably had a moment like this, where even though I'm the eternal optimist, I had to pause last year and say, I have to admit it. The world we live in is a mess. You know, we have this health crisis, an economic crisis, societal issues, racial issues, environmental issues, geopolitical tension. We just have to say it out loud. And of course, then add, what's the definition of madness? Do the same thing and hope for a different outcome. There's no doubt, right? We need this refoundation of business and society around, you know, better principles. On my FBI most wanted list before the pandemic, and I think after the pandemic, it was two people, Milton Friedman, right, shareholder primacy and this obsession about profit, and B, Bob McNamara, the former Secretary of Defense, who was the model of scientific top-down management. These approaches don't work. So, I think the conversation today is about how do we move forward, and I was happy to bring this contribution. I want to add my voice. I mean, you have your voice out there. I want to add my voice and my energy to this discussion and to this necessary and urgent refoundation of business and society around better principles.
And, you know, although your book, Hubert, is very, very practical, it's also full of metaphors and noble concepts. And the metaphor that is central to the book, that is actually part of the cover also, is the heart. In fact, in the book, you actually have something which I absolutely love, which is a business electrocardiogram. So tell us about the primacy of the heart in business and the business electrocardiogram.
Yeah, thank you for highlighting this. You yourself have very good tools, you know, at Thrive Global that help companies deal with the wellness and well-being of employees. So we share that passion for practical tools. And I think we're going to post the, because it's the first and I think only business electrocardiogram that can help people assess the health of the heart of your business. It's 20 questions. It's accessible. It's for free. Why did I focus on the heart? So a big mistake I made, Arianna, for many years, maybe I was not the only one, but still, was to have my head cut off from the rest of my body as a leader. I thought that leadership was about being smart, being the smartest person, and being this, some kind of superhero who can save the day because I know, right? I have the answers. I'm the know-it-all. And I think it's our common friend Satya who's you know, talked about as leaders, we need to move from being the know-it-all to the learn-it-all. So we're in a shift. One of the things I've learned, certainly during the pandemic and over so many years, is that as leaders, we now need to lead with all of our body parts, the head, but also the heart, the soul, the guts, the ears, the eyes. And, you know, it stems from a discussion, which I think is really fundamental. And it's the discussion of why do we work, right? Why are we even in business? Is work a curse because some dude sinned in paradise? You're multilingual, Arianna, so you know that in French, work is travail, which comes from Latin tripalium, which is an instrument of torture. So is that how we see work, or do we see work as something we do so that we can do something else that's more fun? Or is work part of our quest for meaning, part of our fulfillment as individuals? And this idea of heart maybe comes in part from the Lebanese poet Khalil Gibran, who said, work is love made visible. Work is love made visible. That's so profound. And once you've had this determination, then you have to look at business differently. Because what is a company? A company at the end of the day is a human organization made of individuals working together in pursuit of a goal. And so that goal, like for in our lives, has got to be more than for profit. It has to have to do something to do with doing something good to other people, the golden rule. So that's where the hard discussion comes in.
And so this is really the paradox that although I feel very blessed to be able to say that for me, work is love made visible, and you've been very blessed to be able to say the same. There is a danger that when we love our work, we can become totally identified with our jobs. And we've seen that with people whose total identification with work leads to burnout, to reducing the importance of other aspects of their lives. So how do you see that?
And I'll ask you a question because I love how you are helping so many deal with this. In 2012, Arianna, I wrote an article in the Star Tribune, which is the local Minneapolis newspaper. The headline was, I am not the CEO of Best Buy. I have this job, but that's not my identity. And so yeah. While I'm going to be, and there was a whole story about why I did this, but I'll skip it. But there was I can be passionate about my job, about my purpose, but my identity is not stuck with it. And so I said in the article that one of the things I would do at some point is pass the baton of CEO to somebody else, this amazing woman, Corey Barry, who is now the CEO of the company. But my purpose in life would not change, yeah. Right? And my purpose in life is to, you know, try to make a positive difference on people around me and use the platform I have to make a positive difference in the world, which for me today is helping the next generation of leaders, you know, be the best they can be. So I think why we can be all in, and I think it's good to be all in, there's still a distance from an identity standpoint, so that we don't get confused. And you see leaders get lost in their job and their identity. And then when they don't have that job anymore, they don't exist anymore.
Yes.
So I think, and it's all about self-reflection. Maybe I want you to do a bit of an infomercial about how you help people be more self-reflective and don't get lost in the Zoom madness that we've been in, so that, you know, we can be the best leaders we can be. I don't have the corner of wisdom. If somebody has, you may.
Well, you know, Hubert, we find that it's so important to be 100% in, as you said, but also realize that we are more than our jobs. And paradoxically, because truth is always paradoxical, when we realize that, we are better at our jobs because we are more willing to take risks. We are more willing perhaps to fail along the way, because anytime you play it completely safe, you are missing a lot of opportunities. And also, we are more able to recharge and take care of ourselves so that we make decisions from a deeper, more connected place. And I think that connected place is with the heart. Yeah. And right now, as we are basically rethinking business, rethinking leadership, yeah, at the same time, CEOs have a real sense of urgency about the everyday, about people returning to work. Is it hybrid? Is it all remote? All these decisions have to be made with imperfect data. So of the many themes in the book, which are the themes that you think would be most useful right now for the urgent questions that leaders are facing?
Oh, what's fascinating with the urgent questions that leaders are facing is there's no playbook for them, yeah, right? The pandemic was there. Did you have a playbook for the pandemic? the back to the office discussion, there's no playbook, right? And so as leaders, I think there's a huge shift. The 20th century model, all of these myths about leadership, of the leader, as I mentioned, of the superhero who knows everything, who's there to save the day, and who's driven too often by power, fame, glory, or money, that doesn't work anymore, right? The kind of leadership that people want to follow today is much more authentic, much more purposeful, and vulnerable. And, you know, maybe I'll point to a couple of ideas. Last year, during the pandemic, when we couldn't go outside, I think something that great leaders did, it was so impactful, was to go inside and spend time with themselves and trying to define, you know, how do I want to be remembered after the pandemic? What are going to be the guiding principles for my leadership during this time? And then, of course, the other thing they did, which I think is still very, very relevant, and which you practice, is, you know, taking care of yourself as a person. Because if you lead others, you need to lead yourself first. So remember, Arianna, a long time ago, when we were flying on airplanes, that was a long time ago, when the oxygen mask would come down, we were told, put the mask on yourself first before you can help others. So everything we can do to breathe, right? All of the microsteps you talk about, meditation, journaling, reflection, a group of friends, maybe your spouse or partner, to take care of yourself and be kind with yourself, right? Is so critically important. And be able to say, you know, we've had some tough moments in the last 18 months, and being able to share with them, with people around us, This has been my worst moment. My good, my wonderful wife, Hortense, whom you know, asked this question to our clients. Which was your best moment last year, or in the last 18 months? Which was your worst moment? How did you feel? what did you learn? And what does that say about how, your leadership going forward? So we're very far from the know-it-all. And that's necessary because the truth is we don't have the answer. And we have to be able to say, my name is Hubert. I need help. This is what I know. This is what I don't know. And this is how I'd like to work together so that we can get to an answer and be really humble about it.
I totally agree with that. Because while leaders have to go through the urgent decisions facing them, and there is a lot that can help them in the heart of business, and we are also in the middle of a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to redefine productivity, to redefine how we live and how we work. So would love to ask you, suddenly a lot of what CEOs and HR leaders thought were being a good employer, like offering free food or ping pong tables or a DJ, they seem very pre-pandemic. And suddenly now, companies are looking at how can you embed support for well-being and mental health into the workflows, into the working day, so that they're really part of the fabric of work rather than a nice-to-have perk of work. So how do you see that change?
Yeah, and it's excuse me for a second. Wellness is important. I just drank some water, so thank you. I think it's as part of this reinvention is the idea of putting people at the center of business, at the heart of business. And, you know, for decades, companies have said, oh, people are my most important asset, right? We've all heard this. But when the going gets tough, you know, people, you know, you've seen these turnarounds where people announce 10,000 layoffs and the share price goes up. And when I started at Best Buy, that was the advice I was getting, cut, 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 like if people were the problem. And so what I've learned in the last, you know, several years leading Best Buy was, what does it mean to concretely put people at the center? And I agree with you, it's not the ping pong table. So, I mean, they're fine, but, you know, that doesn't do that. In the worst days at Best Buy, it meant starting with listening to the frontliners, right? And asking, they knew what was working well and what was not working. And my job was easy. It had to do with listening to them. And there was a lesson here just to start with people. And my compatriot, René Descartes of the Cartesian philosophy said, I think, therefore I am, right? I think he's wrong. It's I am seen, therefore I am. And if we can create an environment where everybody at the company, every single individual, you know, can feel that they are seen, that they exist, that they matter, and that they can be the biggest, most beautiful version of themselves, it's quite extraordinary. So that was one vignette from the turnaround. And then when we moved to the second phase of our journey, which was building the new blue, when we started to decide, you know, what kind of company do we want to become and how do we accelerate our growth? I think the magic, Arianna, was about creating an environment where everybody at the company could connect what drives them with their work and with the purpose of the company. You see many companies today define their purpose, right? Everybody's doing this, but then it stays on the website and then nothing happens. And so, of course, you need to make the purpose the cornerstone of the strategy, but then you need to go all the way to connect, helping everybody connect, you know, what drives them with their work. So I had a store general manager, we're going to be very far from ping pong tables. He asked every one of his associates in the store, about 100 of them, what is your dream at Best Buy or outside of Best Buy? And he would write it down. They would write it down in the break room. And then he said, my job is to help you achieve your dream. Mm-hmm. Right? And that was pre-pandemic. I think the question today was be not only what is your dream, but what is your biggest struggle? And yeah, how, let's talk about it. And I don't know whether I can solve your biggest struggle, but at least let's talk about it. And I know for me, you know, it was in February, when I learned that my two parents, who are 86 and 88, so they're still kids, but you know, they're aging, but both had COVID. My father didn't have any symptoms, but my mother did, and she didn't have to go to the hospital, but for 2 weeks, I was scared, right? And she's recovering, but she's still not her full self. But you know, that's what everybody has been going through. Okay. And that has led to reflections. I know you'll agree with me on that, on the part of many, many people. I said, what is important? How do I measure, how do I define my success? How do I define my life? And this question at the heart of business of the meaning of our life and the meaning of our work is really essential. So as companies, if we can create an environment where all of us can be vulnerable, can be ourselves. And I'll finish with something that has always stuck in my mind, which is Cammy Scarlett, our head of HR and our head of stores at Best Buy at the time, one day decided to share with everyone at the company. For years, she'd been struggling with depression following the deaths of her two parents. Who talks about mental health as a senior executive, right? Aren't we supposed to be strong?
Yeah.
This had a sea change. This had a huge impact on the company. She received hundreds of emails because all of a sudden she signaled that it was okay to be struggling and that we could help each other. And of course, you know, you've seen and you've been an actor in this. Companies deploy, on the job mental health and wellness programs to support the struggle. At any moment before the crisis, I think people say maybe 20% of a population, human population, would suffer from some kind of mental health issues. What is it now? Is it 50, 60, 80% of us who are struggling and need help? So again, this is a huge shift in the leadership of companies, and all of our common friends who lead companies are embracing that because they know it matters. And even our good friend Jeff Bezos, in his last shareholder letter, wrote that while for, 27 years, they had put becoming Earth's most customer-centric company as his main mission, he's adding now a second mission, which is to become Earth's best employer and best place to work and safest place to work for employees. Because we all know that if we don't have a robust, exciting value proposition for our employees, you know, they're not going to be with us. They have a choice.
Yes, especially now as we are seeing the great resignation and people giving up jobs. And some of it is an aftermath of the pandemic, but some of it is kind of deeper. As you said, it's people looking at what is success, what matters. But these were topics that you were engaging with even pre-pandemic. And some of them were at the heart of the strategies you used to turn around Best Buy. So tell us about that.
Yeah, and you know, in one of the... So I am somebody who's evolved from being a heart-changing, deeply analytical, you know, McKinsey consultant to somebody who now believes in human magic, Arianna. And I didn't smoke anything illegal, I can promise, as part of that journey. And I want to define what magic is, because I think magic is, to a large degree, explains the surprisingly delightful and the delightfully surprising resurgence of Best Buy, certainly in the last few years. And, one day, and remember back in 2012, you know, quality of service in our stores had deteriorated. Quite, you know, frankly, it was not great. But fast forward to 2018, it was one day a young mother who comes to our store, one of our stores, with her young child, maybe 3 or 4 year old. For a holiday, the child had gotten a dinosaur toy as a gift. Was very happy, except the dinosaur got sick. The way we know the dinosaur got sick is the head was dismantled from the body. So that's how, you know. But the boy wanted, that the dinosaur be cured. So they go back to the store where they had bought the product. And at most stores, you know, you would have been sent to the toy aisle, and with some luck, you would have been able to buy a new dinosaur toy. But that's not what happened in that store on that day. There's two wonderful Best Buy Blue Shirt associates who saw and understood what happened. They took the sick dinosaur, they went behind a counter and started performing a surgical procedure on the dinosaur. And if you've been watching Good Doctor on Amazon, you know how they walk they would walk the child through the steps in the procedure. And of course, substituted a new dinosaur, but gave back to the child a cured dinosaur. Now, here's a question, Arianna. Do you think at the time there was a standard operating procedure at Best Buy on how to deal with sick dinosaurs? Or maybe even better, a letter from me, you know, on how to deal. No, of course not. These two associates found it in their heart and felt they had the freedom to do what they did. And when I heard about that story, this was a time when the performance of the company was really accelerating. And I thought, this is it. You know, at scale, we have tens of thousands of Best Buy employees who feel that they're not in the retail business, they're in the happiness business. Mm-hmm. And that created this irrational performance. And so the challenge for leaders is, how do you create the environment that can help create, unleash that magic? And in the book, of course, being French, I talk about the five ingredients. I give the recipe.
Yes.
for unleashing human magic. And it's a very different approach than the old Bob McNamara, you know, top-down approach of, you know, telling people what to do. We could do a survey on this during this conversation, but raise your hand if you like to be told what to do. You like to be told what to do, Arianna?
By you, Hubert, I wouldn't mind if I'm talking. Sometimes if you trust someone, you can be told, but it's not a command.
That's right.
That's different when you are also engaged in the solution. But, you know, I love the recipe for unleashing magic. So would you please walk us through the ingredients?
The five ingredients, and I must say, I learned so much from my colleagues at Best Buy who are magicians. So the first ingredient is about this idea of connecting dreams. Right? Connecting what drives people with their work, and then, you know, how the work connects with the purpose of the company. I shared with you, you know, how the store general manager was asking these associates, you know, about their dream. But that's something that all of us can do. And I actually did back in 2016 with my executive team. We had a dinner with the executive team where I asked every one of the team members to bring a picture of themselves when they were little. So we had really cool, you know, cute pictures. And over dinner, we shared with each other our life story and what drives us in life, you know, our purpose in life. This was transformative because what it did is helped us realize that these executives were actually, surprise, surprise, human beings. And that with one or two exceptions, most of us shared, you know, the desire to do something good in the world. And that led us to want to do much more than just increase the share price of Best Buy, but say, let's build a company that everybody's going to love, that the customers are going to love, but also the employees, the community, and the shareholders. So this idea of connecting dreams. The second ingredient is about creating an environment where there's genuine, authentic human connections, right? Where everybody can feel that they belong, right? So I shared with you this idea of I am seen, therefore I am, as opposed to, yeah, you know, I think, therefore I am. Or that's where, of course, the whole discussion about diversity and inclusion comes into play. The third ingredient is about autonomy. Creating an environment where, as an individual working at a company, I have an influence on things. I'm just not told what to do. And so for us leaders, that means, you know, making sure we push down as many decisions as possible, as far down as possible, and provide, you know, the autonomy for people who are closer to the action. As the CEO, I don't need to make all of these decisions. I can provide input, but I don't need to be making the decision. It's about mastery. So as human beings, we like to master something. And here's one thing I've learned about this. Yes, training is important, but individualized coaching, one employee at a time, is much better. here's why. Let's imagine for a second, it's not true, but let's imagine for a second that Roger Federer and I have the same tennis coach. Okay, it's not true, but let's imagine. I can guarantee that the coach would say something different to Roger than to me. And so that means in our large organizations, and I don't care whether it's 1,000 people or a million, it's one individual at a time that we have. And we did this at scale. Each associate every week would have a coaching session with their supervisor. And then the fifth ingredient is about creating a growth environment. So Carol Dweck talks beautifully about this, which includes the ability to fail. You know, one of the things that, again, Jeff Bezos talks beautifully about is, you know, if you're not ready to fail, that means you're not trying, you're not experimenting, right?
Yeah.
So these are the five ingredients. Easy to list them, very interesting to do this at scale. And in the book, we give a lot of very practical, you know, how to advise. The book is really a guide for leaders who are eager to move in this direction of leading with purpose and humanity. So I hope it's helpful to many leaders. And by the way, all of us are leaders, right? At the minimum, we're leaders of our lives. So there you have it.
But I love the fact that you are able to make it so practical and yet so aspirational and deal with some very, very big ideas. And you mentioned the need to nurture a growth environment because growth, as you say in the book, is an essential ingredient of unleashing human magic. And you also talk about how hard it is to feel energized or creative in the middle of uncertainty. And as we are going to be going through many, many years of uncertainty, the truth is that times of certainty are over. If there is anybody who thinks we'll come out of this pandemic and suddenly as a leader you can just do maintenance, that's not going to happen.
No.
So given that, what are some of the tools people can use to deal with uncertainty? What we are finding, Hubert, is that people can no longer manage their lives, let alone lead, without connecting with a deeper part of themselves.
It is so essential what you've just said. It goes back to this question of purpose. And, you know, following the pandemic, there's many companies that whose top line has been hurt, right? In fact, later this week, I'm going to be with the leadership team of a travel management company, my former company, Carlson Vagon de Travel. As you can imagine, corporate travel is down. So imagine this company in New York City, where you and I live, you know, there's been many restaurants that have been hurt. So a common question for companies, how do I find growth? And I think if we define our strategy based on the way we've been doing business, like if at Best Buy we had said, we are a brick and mortar consumer electronics retailer, you know, we'd be dead. So the idea of anchoring the strategy in a noble purpose, I think is a very powerful idea. And this noble purpose, you know, it can be found at the intersection with, you know, what the world needs, key human needs. Number two, what I'm uniquely good at. Number three, what we are passionate about. And number four, how we can make money. That can lead to defining a much more inspiring, but also much bigger business opportunity. So at Best Buy, at some point we said, we're actually not a retailer, right? We're actually in the happiness business, but more precisely, we said, we're in the business of enriching lives through technology by addressing key human needs, which has led us to get into the health space, as well as getting into, you know, launching an in-home advisor program, which is where we go to people's home, you know, if their need is complex, and, you know, our dream is to become their CIO or CTO for their home, which is, of course, what everybody needs. And similarly, if you're Ralph Lauren Corporation, I'm on the board of that company. If you just define yourself, which they don't, but if you were to define yourself as an apparel company, you know, you'd be in trouble because who's buying clothes now? Certainly nobody's buying bottoms, right? Maybe tops, but no bottoms. But if, you know, you're like Ralph and you have this dream of a company that's there to enable the dream of a better life, there's many, many product categories you can get into and a different connection you can build with your customers. So this anchoring around needs again, vastly expands the addressable market, and to your point, provides a human connection to the heart. And that's why I believe that the first thing that's the heart of business is this idea of pursuing a noble purpose and treating profit as an outcome, not the ultimate goal.
Yes, because that way you are meeting a real human need that goes beyond the product you're selling.
Exactly.
And that's kind of the paradox in so much of your book, that really in order to turn around a company, to satisfy shareholders, you have to be thinking beyond shareholders. And were shareholders always happy with that? Did you have problems with some shareholders who said, hey, you know, Milton Friedman was right, stop all this talk about stakeholders. It's all about profit in the end.
So shareholders are a very important stakeholder. You know, in the US, certainly, you know, they manage our savings for our retirement. So we want them to do well, right? But when you read what some of the largest funds have been saying in the last 3 or 4 years, including Larry Fink, who's been writing to the CEOs of large companies, same with State Street and Vanguard, they're very clear. They're smart. They know that a company that has a noble purpose, a long-term strategy, takes care of all of the stakeholders, is going to create a better outcome. You know, if you're based in Minneapolis, you know, following the horrible murder of George Floyd, you know that if the city's on fire, you cannot open your stores.
Yeah.
You cannot run a company. If the planet is on fire, you don't have much of a business. So I once shared with our shareholders that our purpose was not to make money. It was a great outcome. And by the way, our share price has gone from $11 to $110. So they knew that we care deeply about them. But it's more effective to treat it as an outcome of a set of great strategies. And the shareholders know this. Now, Arianna, when I studied in 2012, if I had told them, look, it's all going to be about stakeholders and kumbaya, they would have said, you know, who is this guy? Right? They already said, who is this guy? When my appointment was announced, share price went down 10%. So here you go.
The world doesn't trust people with accents, Hubert.
They love us, though. They may not trust us, but they love us. And so initially, the focus was on driving performance, but again, with a very human-centric approach. And I think that, you know, sometimes people oppose stakeholder capitalism and shareholder capitalism. I think it's a mistake. I think stakeholder capitalism is about embracing all stakeholders in a declaration of interdependence. The world needs a declaration of interdependence where business knows that we cannot be successful, you know, just within our four walls if the world is on fire outside of us. And so it's by, and of course, what's happening also, so shareholders are demanding more responsible, you know, business behaviors. Employees are. They want to work with a company they respect and where they're going to find meaning and opportunity. Customers want to do business, you know, with responsible businesses. And so I think the debate is over. And for me, for most business leaders, it's not whether we should move in that direction. I think everybody agrees. The question is more how, which again is where, you know, I've tried in this book to offer some very practical advice on how. It's for leaders at all levels who are eager to move in that direction. At the end of each chapter, you know, we've put a set of self-reflective question on, you know, what does that mean? What can I do? And so that's the idea is how do we move? Because it's clear that we have a few ticking time bombs. And I have 3 wonderful granddaughters, ages 9 months to 2.5 years. I think we need to do better for them.
Absolutely. And also, as a Stanford economist said, a crisis is a terrible thing to waste.
Yeah.
So let's use this crisis as a catalyst.
Yeah.
We have a question, Hubert, about the role of board of directors. You're on many boards now. So the question is, how can a board of directors enhance sustainable long-term corporate culture, creating value and strengthening capitalism?
Yeah, I think that the boards I'm on, certainly, you know, if you think about J&J, what an extraordinary company. They since 1943, they've had their credo that embraces all stakeholders, right? And I talked about Ralph Lauren as well. And so from a board standpoint, yes, it raises an interesting question, which is what should be the focus of boards? Historically, the focus of boards were making sure you have the right CEO and the right team. Of course, we have to look at their compensation because that's a board decision. Making sure we have a strategy and that the strategy is working. And making sure that nobody goes to jail, right? It's about compliance, right? I think there's a fourth leg that's, or maybe a fourth and a fifth leg, right? Which is about looking at our overall impact on all stakeholders. So, of course, shareholders with the focus on ESG, right? Environmental, societal, and governance are helping with that. There's a lot of work on defining metrics, trying to hold boards accountable, therefore management team. There's also, I think, a need to focus on culture. Because if you believe that the true engine of success is human magic, you need to understand whether the company is creating that environment that can unleash human magic. And the thing is, you're unlikely to, from the boardroom, in the same way that somebody, when I joined Best Buy, one of my colleagues told me, Hubert, you're not gonna be able to lead the company sitting at your conference table looking at spreadsheets. I think it's the same for boards. And I think some of the most productive time I've had on boards is when we go out. So at Best Buy, we would take our board to a market. They would talk to frontline employees. They would see what's really happening on the front line. So as board members, we need to find different ways to look at culture and how are people feeling? What metrics do we use? Do we get any reporting on burnouts, right? These are new things. It's not about boards, you know, replacing management, because that'd be crazy. Yeah. But I think there's a set of new, with this new era, I think there's new dimensions that boards need to look at and are in fact looking at, of course.
Yes, I saw that, you know, very clearly when I was on the board of Uber, that if the role of a board is really to manage risk,
yes,
including succession and cybersecurity, etc., burnout is a risk.
Yes.
And in fact, the SEC now, as you know, for the first time, has asked companies to report on what they are doing for their employees. It's kind of an extraordinary moment because so far, the only requirement from companies was to let the SEC know how many employees they have. Now they have to also report on what they are doing around recruitment, development, attrition, etc.
And around diversity and inclusion, you know, looking at that, whether it's in part of the, you know, SEC file documents, a different discussion. But I think companies as leaders, we have to look at the different dimensions and key drivers of our overall performance and to the benefit of the various shareholders. So it's a time of change. It's also an exciting time, I feel, because there's so much to be invented on how to build, you know, this new model of leadership for the greater good. So I'm excited about it.
And so am I, very excited about this time we're living through. And there are many questions, but I want to go to a different question, which is, I'd love to hear more about the books you each recommended. What about them inspires you most? In what ways have they shaped your outlook?
You begin, Arianna.
Just pick one, so you have more time to pick more. And the Marcus Aurelius Meditations book that I picked is my favorite book on leadership until I read yours, Hubert. It's actually on my nightstand, and every night I read at least a page, because Marcus Aurelius was, as you know, the emperor of Rome.
Yeah.
For 19 years, 13 of which he had to deal with a terrible plague. He faced invasions, betrayals, every crisis you can imagine, but he was also a Stoic philosopher. So he writes about how to go through crisis, how to lead while remaining unflappable. Like, how can you stay in the eye of the hurricane? While everything around you is in turmoil. And I feel this is such an important book for our times. And often when I discuss these ideas with busy CEOs, I may get, oh, you know, Arianna, I have such a big job. I can't really do these things, or I can't take time to put my own oxygen mask on first. And so my response is, hey, you know, Marcus Aurelius had a big job too. And he did it. So I think we all need role models. So for me, Marcus Aurelius is a great role model of leadership. Now, what about you?
My top of the list is, of course, Thrive by Arianna Huffington. I told you I read it over Christmas last year. Actually, I did not read it. I listened to it, and you told me it's your sister who is reading it.
Sounds like me.
I could see you, but then you told me it was your sister. And it's about how we measure success. It's about, you know, you talked about ingredients, right? And I have them here. It's about well-being, wisdom, wonder, and giving. So I think for anyone who wants to thrive in this new era, Arianna, some magical words for and of course your sister. So that would be one. Very briefly, I'll hit the others. Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning. Oh my God, that's foundational. I think it's right up there with Marcus Aurelius. Yes. This is somebody who spent, you know, the war in a concentration camp and was able to survive because he felt, he was thinking, he was visualizing life after camp and what all of the wonderful things he would do. Marshall Goldsmith, the father of all executive coaches, and I give credit to Marshall for helping me along the journey of becoming a better leader. What got you here won't get you there.
Yeah.
In the first stage of her career, so much focus on being smart and getting things done and so forth. That doesn't work in the second part of her career, where it's more about creating the right environment for others to survive. Just Mercy, of course, you know, by Stevenson is such a profound way to learn about the experience of Black African-American friends and colleagues and members of our community, which was, I heard him the first time at the Art Institute in Minneapolis. I was in shock when I heard what he had to say. And the last one, of course, is Marcel Proust, In Search of Lost Time, only 3,000 pages of the most adorable and charming, you know, romantic experience by this amazing French author. So here you have it, quite diverse.
I love that. And I love the fact that you included a novel, which is also a rumination on life and philosophy and our awareness of time. So Thank you. Really beautiful. So just a couple more questions before we have to end. One is about B Corps. You know, there is a lot of conversation now about B Corps. And what do you think are historic standard systems of businesses that are well constructed and well respected that can lead to more holistic business decisions from the beginning? Or do you think all that has to be rethought and reconsidered?
Yeah, I'm a bit on the fence on this. You know, the question is, do companies need to become B Corps as opposed to C Corps to be able to lead from a place of purpose and humanity? And I think that maybe getting to a, you know, changing to being a B Corp is helpful. I don't think it's necessary, and I think it's potentially distracting because it's a, so why is it not necessary? I think that in the US, and I could be mistaken, right? But I've heard, you know, Marty Lipton talk about it in particular. In Delaware, in particular with the question of business judgment, as leaders, as boards, we actually have the freedom to do what makes sense and with business judgment, make decisions to invest in your people or in the community if it's for the greater good in the end. So I've never felt constrained meeting Best Buy by the fact, now Best Buy was actually a Minnesota company. I think in Minnesota, we actually have the right to take into account the different stakeholders. The reason why I'm not sure it's a priority to move to a B Corp is that it focuses on the legal aspect. And for me, the biggest change doesn't need to be legal. It needs to be in our heart. So change needs to start from within. Now, if at some point you've done everything with your heart and you feel you're constrained by the legal structure of the US corporation, then you know maybe you can move to a B Corp. But that's not where I would stand. I'm not saying I'm right. It's just an opinion. That's not where I think we need to stand to start.
Well, that's actually very consistent with the whole book, because in a sense you are saying we are talking about a big business leadership cultural transformation, and focusing just on one aspect may just kind of miss the big noble purpose that lies ahead.
Yeah, and at the end of the book, in the conclusion, there's a call for action, which actually starts with each of us. Each of us get to decide how we want to live our life and how we want to lead, what kind of a leader we want to be. Then that, you know, it goes to, you know, what the companies do and their boards. And then, of course, you can have a discussion. There's I think all of us need to lead. So there can be a discussion at the ecosystem level. So Paul Polman, whom you know is the former CEO of Unilever, is doing some very interesting work with Imagine, where he's taking a number of industry sectors. So there's the fashion pack, and he's doing the same in food, where he takes a bunch of companies, major companies in the sector, and have them work together on how can we build a more sustainable model? Because sometimes it's at the industry level, for example, in apparel, that you can change the dyeing techniques or technology, how cotton is grown and so forth. So I think that's an interesting one. I think investors also have something to do. The proxy advisory firms, you know, ISS and Glass Lewis, maybe they have some work to do, and I'm sure they're doing it on how do we evaluate the performance of a CEO? Today, it's only the TSR, total shareholder return. Should we broaden the criteria? Brian Moynihan, you know, the CEO of B of A, in his capacity as head of the International Business Council, has led some really interesting work on metrics for companies. It's not just profit. What are the different areas where we need to measure? So I think in 1789, maybe I'll end with this. So Louis XVI, King of France, turned to Monsieur de La Rochefoucauld after the Bastille had been stormed. And he said, "Is this a revolt?" And Monsieur de La Rochefoucauld's answer was, "No, sire, this is a revolution." I think he was right.
Yes, so you think we're in the middle of a revolution?
I think it's a necessary revolution. I hope we make it a revolution with a sense of urgency, because there's a few ticking time bombs. If we don't take care of them, you know, it's going to be a mess, and my granddaughters are not going to be happy with me.
Well, the heart of business is an amazing playbook to take us through the revolution without the guillotine. Thank you so much, Hubert. Thank you for writing the book. Thank you for your leadership. And thank you for being such an amazing teacher, as well as leader, CEO, and writer. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Arianna. You're such an amazing friend. Thank you for what you're doing in the world, helping so many companies and employees, you know, deal with the mess in which we're in and have a better life. So thank you. You inspire me.
Thank you so much. A bientôt.
Thank you. A bientôt. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you for joining us tonight. We are playing closing slides. This slide contains an image of the featured book. The cover illustration is formed in the shape of a heart and shows a diverse crowd of people walking about in work attire. The text reads, "Hubert Joly, The Heart of Business, Leadership Principles for the Next Era of Capitalism." The Heart of Business is available for purchase from the library shop, on.nypl.org/shoplive. Proceeds benefit the New York Public Library. Reserve a copy for free with a New York Public Library card. Visit tonight's event page to find this title in a variety of formats. nypl.org/live.